Very good afternoon to you, and wishing you wonderful, wonderful year ahead. Let us begin today's class by thanking PGP office for giving us a wonderful day to do our classes. Fortunately, this is happening online, so we can log in and then, you know, go for afternoon siesta to make up for our yesterday night's fantastic party. I hope all of you are with me and continue with me till the end of the class. we are going to have some very important issues to discuss today. And those issues we've been trying to complete for last almost two sort of slots, but haven't been. So hopefully we'll be able to complete. Keeping your convenience and general sort of celebratory mood of the day, I had decided to reschedule the new case discussion to the following slot, and hence we are not going to have Air France case discussion, as you would have come to know from the email that Kripa, our good friend, had sent you. So we would only be discussing Banacol case and continue our discussions on media planning, which we are trying to do for quite some time. I can see Christopher, Happy New Year. All right, so Christopher is in no mood. He's, I think, kind of struggling because perhaps still the effect of vodka is there. Anyway, Christopher, you kind of try to concentrate as much as you can against all odds. I will come back to you, knowing your analysis of Banacol case. But before that, just to help you recap, I think it's important to pick up the thread, in these turbulent times as we are occupied with so many issues. So last time we were looking at, first of all, in larger context, we are looking at integrated marketing communication. Out of the five major mode of communications, we are focusing on advertising campaign planning. Within advertising campaign planning, we spent hours discussing creative strategy and execution. Now we are looking at media planning and execution. If you remember, we were looking at variety of different media planning related concepts, and then we started looking at media plan development, where you begin with situation analysis, look at variety of different researches which connect actually consumer at the center, more importantly, with the media as well as the product category, how they consume that product category. And then we also look at how various brands in the product category use media. And all this data, as we know by now, are available through readership surveys, viewership surveys, listenership surveys. And also you have data coming from the competitive spend researches like ADX MMP, which provide information about the share of voice, share of spend by brands. We were looking at once you do situation analysis, you fix your advertising media objective in terms of how many people you want to reach, how many times. So essentially you're looking at reach and frequency. The frequency essentially, is the most important element, because if you don't reach the audience at the right frequency, they don't understand your message, and you end up creating your communication list. For example, we will spend more time discussing media planning to ensure that the full understanding and comprehension takes place among you. Otherwise, we will do something, part discussion, move, we'll complete the entire course, but none of the concepts would be clear. So whatever we do, we should do it at a, effective level, and more number of times you communicate, chances that the people would have better understanding. Of course, there's a limit afterward. Additional advertising exposures may not have much impact. So that also have to keep in mind. So you have to figure out what is the effective frequency, and for a given budget, what would be the effective reach at that frequency you can get is something that you try to do. Now, having got these objectives very clear for your media plan, you then will have to look at what's your budget. Now, the budget actually goes hand in hand with the total exposures that you create under a plan or a campaign. And hence, SOV, SOM method is one way in which you try to estimate what are called gross exposures for a given period with respect to competition, with the share of voice. And then, translate that into cost by looking at what rate you can buy these exposures at best. So we were looking at one of the ways in which you can estimate that is SOV, SOM. the whole idea is that share of market and share of voice go hand in hand. You try to make some finer adjustment to the target market share or the existing market share, and then work out your gross exposures by looking at share of voice. Obviously, when you look at the category exposures, you will find your exposure, and then you can find out how much amount of money you can buy that for. The other approach that you have fixed the budget is what is called awareness trial ratios. And what you're looking at is ultimately advertising exposures through media planning. How many audiences you effectively reach has to result into what you call sales. So how exposure leads to awareness, awareness leads to trial, trial leads to purchases, and eventually the volume of sales happen. You can work out these ratios based on the past campaign data and then use them to plan future campaigns based on the targeted sales volumes that you're looking at. So, and of course, then you can also have what is called advertising to sales ratio, advertising expenditure as percentage of sales, which you can consider in a very stable, steady kind of category in which your brand is operating. And we, having decided this budget, you have to figure out that how you are going to allocate this across different market segments, particularly geographic segments or territories, because it would not be appropriate to spend the entire budget very uniformly across all the regions. Because there are certain regions where there is more potential to sell, there are certain regions where there's less potential to sell. When you uniformly allocate your resources across different segments, you are actually not optimally allocating your resources, and your return on investment is not likely to be there. Please remember that a brand manager survives quite often, of course, sales or top line, bottom line for the brand, but more importantly, his budget is tied to what is called return on investment. And how efficiently you spend your marketing resources, to produce results for the brand is very, very important performance metric. So you have to make sure that you have a right strategy so that, you get better return on investment. So last time you were looking at how do you really go about prioritizing it. And we were saying that one important analytical method that you use here is calculating indexes. And these are brand development index and category development index based on the proportion or dispersion data of target audience. And for the dispersion of the target audience across different region, what is the dispersion of your brand sales and category sales? And when you take this ratio, you would get BDI, CDI. All you have to now look at is a number above 100, number below 100. Generally, you would get an idea as to how well you are doing in that particular segment or a market sub-market to exploit its full potential. And we know that if a number is above 100 index number, it essentially means that you are doing better than what ideally you should do in that market relative to the other markets across the entire nation. So I hope you are now able to remember what we're discussing. So you decide your priority based on BDI and CDI comparison. But first of all, you also have to be aware that, are you looking at a market which is reasonably large in size or very small in size? And accordingly, we were looking at how you can look at it. Once you have an idea about what are your what's your objectives are, how many people you want to reach, what is the effective frequency at which you want to reach them, what's your budget, what's your prioritization of the segments of the market, you are now ready in some sense to take decision of resource allocation across different media class. And media class essentially, as we know, is a broad communication platform like television, radio, print, etc. How you allocate your resources across different media class. Having done that, you will do next decision, which is within that each of these media class, media vehicle decision. But when it comes to media class, you are first of all looking at to what extent that particular media class itself has penetrated into the market. For example, if you're looking at Bihar, Jharkhand, tribal areas and things like that, if people are not literate, print media penetration is not going to be significant, and hence using print media for those audiences is not a good idea. if you are looking at housewife in middle class and wanting to reach them by digital media, perhaps may not be a good idea. A broadcast television prime time channels are a good idea. Youngsters like you, Abhishek, Kanika, and all of you, you are into YouTube and Facebook. So if we have to reach to you, you know, you have to look at digital. So broad media class, how you allocate resources based on going by numbers. And you have the data. Television reaches 95% of people. Mobile reaches 98% of the people. Likewise. And within your target audience, when you look at these reach numbers, you would know that what percentage of target audience is largely exposed to what kind of media platforms, and accordingly you will allocate resources. However, we are not only just concerned with the quantitative information here. We also have to take decision based on the qualitative data. Please understand, leave your engineering and, you know, formula driven mind aside. You have to use that. That's an advantage, but that's not the be all and all. There's a lot of qualitative analysis managers have to do it, and good managers, senior level, has to do that qualitative analysis. So that's very important. And what you look at are the factors like category, medium fit, which is a qualitative variable. The product category that you're advertising, to what extent that is fitting the media platform. You don't expect chewing gum advertising or cola advertising in newspapers too much. You see them on television because the whole idea is to create entertainment. So category fit, medium fit is there. You don't see too much of financial services advertising on television, because there's so much of information to be given, you can't give that in 15 second or 30 second time. So there is something called category medium fit. On the top of it, consumers also don't expect to see certain product category advertised on certain media. Like, for example, Banacol case that we are discussing today very clearly says that, you know, in the American market, margarine is not a product category that you get to see on outdoor media. Hoardings are not something that you talk about. So there are category, there are certain product categories which are generally going with certain kind of media, and even profile of the show quite often decides what kind of. Can you really expect to see an automobile ad on say Ye Rishta Kya Kehlata Hai or Kum Kum Bhagya or something like that? Very rarely you get to see, unless you kind of out to experiment and innovate, you would not do. But you would see, you know, a detergent ad or a fairness cream ad definitely, you know, on shows like, Saath Nibhana Saathiya or whatever that you have. So what I'm trying to say is that the show has certain profile. Audience expect to see certain kind of ads. So it's not just the quantitative, who is the audience? Quality of the audience and their percentages is one part. That's the quantitative data. We are talking about the fit of the program, and this is a qualitative. You also have an issue of creative execution. If your execution demands entertainment, you can't entertain people over print media. This is a boring medium. But if you have a lot of information to share, you want to educate people, you can't do too much on television, because people don't expect to get educated over television. They want to get educated over internet or print media. So what we are trying to say is that the nature of creative execution, product category and the buyer's expectation, and how well they fit with the media class could also be a factor in deciding. So don't just blindly look at the numbers, right? Because many times we feel that, you know, we are MBA, but we are you know, experts in number. We only have to look. Numbers you must look at, you know, otherwise, you know, you are not MBA. So, you know, you have to apply your, you know, managerial skills to, you know, do quantitative analysis, a lot of them. But you also have to look at qualitative analysis to have very evolved, mature, good, sound decisions. Apart from that, you also have issues like production logistics and cost that go into decision of which media class. Now you have budget of 5 crore and you want to develop a television commercial. The television commercial production itself would cost you about anywhere between 50 lakh to 1 crore. And hence, it may not be a good idea to spend that money on that. Instead, rather than, you know, you might like to create something on any other media platform. So cost, production logistics. Now, if you want to advertise, like for example, Virat Kohli, wins matches in Australia Test Series, and you want to advertise VIX, Action 500, because you have Virat Kohli as ambassador. You can't advertise tomorrow, because today the match is won. Tomorrow you want to ride on the sentiment. You can't advertise that tomorrow on television or magazine for that matter, because there's something called logistical issue. You have to make sure that the content is ready, it goes in for the production, and it is available with certain lead time. Because magazines publish every fortnight. If the last issue has come out 2 days before, the next one will come out only after 10 days. Whereas in print media, you can send the artwork by evening, and tomorrow morning it can appear in the newspaper. Or in digital, after 2 hours itself, you would have your ad going online. So what we are trying to say is that there are those issues also you have to look. You also have to look at where your competitors are spending and what is their media mix, in terms of how their total budget is split across different media, and that might also give you an idea. Now, this is what we were discussing in general. Now we get into Banacol case, and last time we were having discussion with Renan, we will not continue with her. I think we will spare her today. We will find another person who is more prepared for today's discussion, and I think Shubham Manuja. How about Shubham? Shubham, have you worked on this Banacol case analysis by any chance? Would you be interested in sharing your analysis with the rest of the people in the class? Shubham Manuja, you have logged out? Or where are you, man? Abhishek Raj. One, two, six, Abhishek. 372, Abhishek Dalal. Abhishek. Are you there? Gone to sleep. Sujata, 300. Hello, Sujata. Sujata. Sujata is also not there. Srijan Jaiswal. Srijan, are you around by any chance? Last and final call, Srijan. We go to 169, Sanjana Reddy. Sanjana, are you around with Banacol case analysis? This is really unfortunate and disappointing, New Year Day. We are beginning on a very bad note in section C.
Yes, sir.
Sanjana.
Yes, sir.
Had you received email from Kripa?
Yes.
So are you prepared with Banacol case analysis?
Yes, sir. I'll open the Excel.
Fantastic. I am, permitting you to share your Excel file with the rest of the class. And we all would be glad if you can explain how did you take the decision. First of all, you tell us what is the problem that, you have to solve at Banacol, Johnson & Johnson. You are the brand manager for Banacol, and you are planning advertising campaign, particularly media planning. And what are the decisions or what is the problem that you are solving today? First you tell us and then you tell us your solution. Sanjana.
So give me 1 minute. I'm just trying to find the file.
Okay. Meanwhile, anyone who's having any question, Sanjana.
Yes, sir. Sorry, sir. 1 minute, and I'm just searching.
There are about 73 curious people waiting to see what
yes,
you
sir,
have.
I'm so sorry. In 1 minute, sir.
Fantastic, Sanjana. Yes.
Yes, sir.
Tell us. What is the problem that you are trying to solve and what is the solution?
Okay. So the first decision that we have to take is we have different customer segments and we need to give weightage to each of these segments depending on our priority, who would be our likely target audience. And we have 9 groups here. And each group differs in one is age, that is 45, above 45 or below 45, I think.
Very good.
And the next one is household income. We have 2 segments. One is above $50,000 and below $55,000 household income.
Mm-hmm.
And there's an age range, like I mentioned, and gender as well, male, female, etc.
Mm-hmm.
And so based on these, we have, and counties as well, county A plus B, county C plus D. Based on all of this, we have to give them weightage factors. So how attractive are these groups? So our first task was to give them these weightages, that is much average, better than average, or much better than average, etc.
Okay.
That is the first decision that we had to do. And when you change those numbers, we would get here how much of these groups would be the percentage of our media.
Okay.
Okay, so 1 minute. So the next task was to give some inputs to these media vehicles. We have different media vehicles here. This is the list. We have Cooking Light, Newsweek, CNN, Fortune. These are all the programs in between which our advertising would be issued.
Right.
And the data given here is for every service, we have how much percentage of the group would be exposed to this particular, let's say, Wall Street Journal. So we have 24% of group one exposed to Wall Street Journal. So we would be capturing that much percentage of this particular group. And also the data given is one issue reach, how many total adults we would be reaching, and the advertisement cost. That is, and the next column gives cost per 1,000 impressions and the ratio of audience to those viewing a single instance. So, So based on this, again, we have to give impact factors, as in which media vehicle would ideally suit our requirements. That is, we need to get the least cost per 1,000 impressions with highest reach to the most attractive target group that we have.
Very good.
Yeah, the next target, decision for us was to give this impact factors for all of these media vehicles.
Okay.
Yeah, so based on, after we input all those decisions, here, again, we need to, this is the next important step. In this, we need to decide how many number of insertions, that is, how many number of times our advertisement would be shown on these channels. And this was our input. We select, so based on the one issue reach and the cost and target weighted CPM, this is based on our target groups. We need to decide how many number of insertions in each of these media vehicles.
Okay.
All of this was based on trial and error. We kept doing simulations multiple number of times, changing the weights to targets group, changing the number of insertions here, so that our and based on all of these inputs, our exposures, our effective reach, and total effective reach, we would get these numbers. One more thing I think I've probably missed out first is this S-curve that we've discussed in the last class. So we selected S-shaped 3 because we felt that is the most effective and most probable frequency that a target audience should be exposed to in order to register our advertisement, but not make it frequently bombarding them that they would be irritated. So based on all of these inputs, our final results would come here. And we got $9.449 cost per effective weighted exposure. And our effective reach was 2,10,000.
Very good. Fantastic. Now, for example, suppose, if I change this to S-shaped 6, right? Yes, this would change your results, effective reach and weighted cost per weighted exposure.
Yes, sir, it would change.
It will become very bad, right? Similarly, if I change the target audience weight, this would change. But that impact target audience weights that you have given, your weighted exposures would change. Sanjana. Wouldn't it change? Similarly, if you change your media impact factor, which you gave as media vehicle input, Sanjana.
Sorry, sir, I got disconnected. 1 minute. Can you repeat the question that you were asking me?
No, I was just trying to say that, how these things are coming, what is the idea of weighted effective reach?
Okay, so like we discussed last class, the meaning of reach and total impressions, based on the weightages that we give to each target group and through
Right. Yes. So suppose if you change your weightages, your weighted effective reach would change.
Yes, sir.
You change your frequency and your weighted effective reach would change, because effective reach is, reaching audiences at effective frequency number of times. You change your media vehicle input, which is the impact factor, where also you have taken decision of, above average, better than worse, or worse than worse, whatever. This will change. Am I right or wrong?
Yes, it will change.
And hence, all the decisions that you are taking, including the 4 decisions that you have indicated. First one is the frequency. Second one is the target group. Third one is the media vehicle impact input. And finally, which media you are selecting with how many insertions. All of them combined would have the effect on this, right? Now, what is the objective? The objective is to reach audience, increase maximum number of people you want to reach effectively, right? That's the objective of any media plan, right?
Yes, sir.
And hence, in a given budget, you would try to maximize this number, Sneha. No, Sanjana.
Yes, sir.
And you would try to minimize this number for the given budget, because you want to have this effective reach of the audiences as much as possible at the minimum cost. Am I right or wrong?
Yes, sir, right.
This is precisely what you have done. Unfortunately, we have to, make sure that how we define what is effective, has to be defended, right? Now, you have defined your effective frequency as 3. How would you like to defend that? Because if you are going wrong there, then this number has got no meaning. Am I right or wrong?
Yes, sir. True.
Because your effectiveness measure itself is wrong. What you define as effective is not effective. Then, this number has no meaning. So while I understand and I fully agree that your overall objective is to, for the given budget that you have constrained, which is about 200,000 or, 2 million, you want to maximize the effective reach. And obviously your cost per weighted exposure should be minimum. But now you tell me, how you took this decision and why you think Shape 3 is the most appropriate. Please understand, this is your decision based on this, this is coming. So you cannot say that, since, this is becoming highest here, I will select Shape 3. You are not doing justice to what, is supposed to be done. Why? Because this decision has to be based on whether the campaign will work and produce results for the brand. Are you getting, Sanjana?
Yes, sir. Understood. So
now tell me why S-Shape 3 is a good idea and not why S-Shape 9 or 6 or decline 9 or 6.
Okay. In the case, there was a graph, sir, which showed us based on the number of exposure per individual, what would be the advertising impact?
That is what it is shown here also. You don't have to go to the case graph. Here also it is the same thing.
Yes, sir. So the incremental effect of these exposures, how many times a person would be exposed to this ad, the effectiveness would get decreased. And based on those values given, we thought an S3.
See, if you look at this S-shaped 3 curve that you right now chosen, right?
Yes, sir.
What does it mean that you can see that, since from 0 to 3 frequency, your advertising impact is increasing, right?
Yes.
So you advertise, people are partially in favor of buying your brand when your advertising is working, basically. Then you advertise second time, they are more likely to buy your brand because advertising is more working. After third time, they would have bought your brand, right?
Yes.
And then afterwards, fourth time you advertise, they've already bought it. They're fully convinced. What is the point in advertising? Are you getting? That is precisely what this saturation essentially means. That after, 3 frequency, additional exposure is hardly having impact. It's the same impact. It's like, we were talking about shooting 3 bullets to dead, a man to kill him. After third bullet, after he's died, if you keep shooting him, you are wasting your ammunition. Am I right or wrong?
Right, sir.
So that is what this saturation is. You should not, shoot more bullets, otherwise, your boss would fire you because you are wasting the, resources, which are very scarce anyway, right? So
yes.
You should, only advertise, expose your audiences only as much time it is effectively required to persuade them. Now the question is this, real question, Sanjana, is this, that is 3 times you expose your audiences about Banacol advertising, they will start buying, or 6 or 9? That is, why do you think that after 3 they will get saturated? That graph in the case is not talking about, that is just the general explanation as to what are this frequency response curve. In case of Banacol, we are now taking decision. We are doing media planning for Banacol of Johnson & Johnson. For Banacol, why do you think 3 is effective frequency. I feel that 9 is the effective frequency. Till the time you advertise 9 times to the people, they will not be able to understand. Now, what do you have to say?
Yes, in the graph that is there, but in the table 4 that is mentioned, that is below the graph, we have the value for 3 times exposure, the learning or risk curve was 0.2. While that value for
I would like to see which table you are talking about.
It's in page number 8, sir.
Okay.
In that table, the values for learning or S curve, which is our focus now, the incremental effects were higher for 3 exposure frequency, but for 6 and with 6, the value is just 0.1. So we thought the most effective one was S-shaped 3 curve.
No, but where is this data coming from? Why do you believe this, that this is going to be the data for Banacol advertising? Have you done an experiment? Where is this data coming from?
It's given in the case, sir.
No, this is not related to Banacol. This is just an explanation of page number, basic media planning metrics onwards, right? Page number, in fact, if you look at, I would say right from page number 2 or 3, this communication goals and budget is okay. I think from basic media planning metrics all the way up to page number 9, page number 8. I think all this is, actually the conceptual understanding which we discuss in the class. It's got nothing to do with Banacol case.
Okay, so we thought it was for this advertisement.
No, how can you assume? So where is it written that this is for Banacol? This is for example it is given, right?
Okay, so we thought this would apply to any advertisement.
No, you tell me, Banacol advertising, if it has to be effective, what should be the effective frequency? You know the case context, which is given in first 2 paragraph and last pages. First 2 pages and last pages. Last couple of pages. Okay.
Yes,
what is the idea of frequency? You have understood, right?
Yes, sir. I understood.
So, suppose now, what do you think it will defend high? When do you think you should have higher frequency, of your exposures? And when do you think you have lower frequency of your exposure? Let's just keep aside the data table as of now. Whatever data table that you have referred to, just tell me.
So I think when the brand is trying to bring in, let's say, a new product and they're trying to educate customers, then the frequency should be higher because the brand is not yet registered in target audience's mind.
Sanjana, you are genius. Absolutely right, actually. But why are you not applying your, intellectual thing here? How old is this? When was this, Banacol launched?
1999, sir.
When are you planning this?
So, planning what?
No, you media planning that we are preparing right now. Which year we are preparing for? This is for 2001.
Yes, sir. 2001. Yeah.
So it is just about a year and a half old, launch.
Okay.
Isn't it a new brand?
Yes, sir.
How old is the category? What product category it belongs to? What is Banacol? What is it? Sanjana?
Yes, sir.
What is Banacol?
So it's a cholesterol lowering brand.
Cholesterol lowering brand is a tablet?
No, sir. I think it's syrup type.
Sorry?
I think it's syrup, not tablet.
My God. You know, I think you'll have to
spread.
have you heard of something called margarine?
Spread. Sorry, sorry. It's not syrup, it's a spread.
And what do you do? Where do you apply? You apply it on your body or where do you spread this?
On toast, so.
On toast is a food item,
Yes.
God's sake. You know, it's not a syrup or a tablet.
Yeah,
But,
no, it's
please
yes.
don't take me there all the way, right? We are talking about a breakfast bread spread.
Yes, sir.
We are talking about a margarine, you know, like butter or you know, cheese spread or something like that, right?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Now, Banacol was launched in 99. When was the first any other brand cholesterol reducing margarine was launched in the market of America, US market?
So in 1999,
This
two
was the
thousand.
first brand to be launched, right? Along with your Take Control.
Yes,
So,
sir.
how old is the category?
The category is also new.
Category is just 2 months, you know, 2 year old,
Year
one and
old.
a half, you know, 2 year old.
Yes, sir.
Now, take a look at. So, first of all, it's a very new category. By any standard, you take toilet or butter, you take, you know, how many years, you know, people have been consuming butter? Almost for 500 years, maybe more, you know, homemade butter and all that, right? Cholesterol reducing margarine, nobody has seen till 2 years before.
Right, sir.
Hello?
It's a new category.
Right? Now, margarine is a new category. No, margarine is like a bread spread. Everybody has seen it. But what is making it more complex to communicate is what is margarine? Margarine is a bread spread. By common sense, by general awareness, Sanjana, of you know, whatever bread spread that you have been exposed to, bread spreads would increase your cholesterol or decrease your cholesterol.
Yes, sir. So that okay, then we have to change the perception of customers
Look
that this
at
is
this, you know,
actually.
this is a category which is counterintuitive benefit.
Yes, sir.
You are going, people have a certain kind of belief, you have to completely shift their belief.
Right, sir, we have to.
And you know, you have just started about a year before.
Yes, sir.
Isn't it a difficult task?
It is difficult, sir.
And what about cholesterol? Everybody in the America at that point in time are, you know, trying, you know, everything that is available at their hand to reduce their cholesterol. Are they so much cholesterol conscious?
No, sir, they were not very.
People are dying with cholesterol. They don't even know what a cholesterol is. Sanjana, are you getting what I'm trying to say? First of all, you have to educate this mother, sorry, these people, you know, as to what are, you know, what is cholesterol reduction is all about, and you know why they should do that. Then you have to educate that, you know, there is something called margarine. You don't have to go to doctor, man. Just apply, you know, enjoy your toast and breakfast, and you know, you will reduce your. I mean, that's so very hard to believe, first of all, Sanjana.
Yes, sir, true.
And it doesn't stop there, Sanjana. You have a competition. The year in which you launch, the same year you have another brand launch. Which is that brand? Sanjana
It's Take Control by Unilever.
is a large company, another large company. If you are Johnson & Johnson, Unilever is not a small company.
Yes, sir.
What is your market share at the end of first year? What is their market share?
So in 2002, our dollar share was 2.2% in the margarine category. And for control sales, so in term for take control, the dollar share is just like 2%.
They are 2%, we are 2.2%.
Yeah,
Are we
on
doing
volume.
better compared to Take Control?
No, not much
No,
better.
2.2 is not better than 2.
And not much better, sir.
Okay, it is slightly better. What do you
Yes,
think about,
slightly.
suppose if you have to take a look at volume share, what is your
Yes.
guess? Take Control is having more volume share or Benecol? You know, this is dollar market share, right?
Yes, sir, yes.
Suppose if you have to take volume market share.
So Take Control, I think, has more volume share because its price is less. So that is $3.79.
Brilliant, Sanjana. So what is the price difference now between Johnson & Johnson Banacol and Lever Brothers Take Control? You have the price data, no? Second page, first paragraph.
Yes, sir. So our price was $4.99.
Right.
But for, that is for a 5.9 ounce package. But for Take Control is $3.79 for a 10 ounce tub.
So we are converted to 10 ounce comparative measure. So what is it like? You will find about $8.5 for 10 ounce for Banacol and compare it with $3.79. It is more than double.
Yes, sir.
The same product. We are not talking about anything else. It's both are cholesterol reducing margarine. And you know what you are selling is more than double the price. Now, where are your margarine? Where are your cholesterol reducing margarine customers are going to come from? Margarine users? Okay. I mean, if I am currently applying bread spread, I will then, you know, you expect me to buy your margarine. Am I right or wrong, Sanjana?
Yes, sir. Yes. We're already habituated to it.
So what is the margarine price? Non-cholesterol reducing, ordinary margarine?
That is $1.19 per pound.
$1.19, and you know, compared to that, you know, what is your price? Pound is about 16 ounces, right?
Yes, sir.
So do you realize that you are selling 10 times higher than the current, you know, product that people are using?
Right, sir.
And you have to win share from these people who are currently using margarine. You want to upgrade them to, you know, 10 times more expensive. So see, for example, if I am buying 10 rupees, you know, margarine, I have to spend 100 rupees to get Banacol to, you know, have the same amount of margarine.
Yes, sir.
Is it easy, Sanjana?
No, sir. I don't think it's easy.
Do you think that, you know, you advertise 3 times and people will, you know, start buying your brand, you know, spend, you know, 10 times more price?
No, sir.
You require 90 frequency to, you know, have a conversion. What are you saying?
Yes, sir. So we were thinking that graph applies to this as well, but now that we know that it's not, then 3 would.
No, I put 3 and, you know, be happy about it, that my weighted effective reach is happening. Obviously, it will be higher, but, you know, your campaign is going to fail.
Yes, sir. It will.
If I have to promote you based on this plan, I will promote you, but then immediately, you know, fire you at the end of the year because your plan is not going to work, I'm sure.
Yes, sir.
It would not sell anything. Your advertising would be wasted.
True, sir. True.
And not just you, Sanjana. J&J brand managers themselves don't know what is this product all about. Forget about consumer, Sanjana. You know, see, the problem here is consumers, you know, are, you know, to be educated. That's what we are arguing for. J&J, Banacol brand managers themselves require education. They themselves don't know what is this Banacol spread all about. Can you imagine? Like you, they are also thinking this is syrup and tablet. Why am I saying so?
So I think it's a new product category and they were trying to differentiate Banacol by marketing as a drug rather than a food.
Look at the last paragraph on page number, you know, 2. How much amount of money J&J has blown off in the first year of launch?
So $49 million, sir.
$49 million. Now, if you have to compare that, it is good, bad, ugly, what will you do?
It's a huge amount, sir.
On what basis are you saying?
So Unilever, compared to Unilever, which spent
in the same year, you have another brand launched by Unilever. How much did they spend first year?
They spent $15 million, sir.
$15 million. What is their market share? What is our market share?
2.2%.
If you go by volume, you know, they are far ahead than us.
Yes, sir.
It's only because our price is double that, you know, we have value market share, which is, you know, slightly better than them. You see what I'm trying to say?
Yes, sir.
This Johnson & Johnson Banacol brand manager have to be fired immediately. Isn't it?
Yes, sir.
on the top of it, after doing that big blunder, they are saying that, oh, this is, you know, not something that can be sold in the consumer market. You know, nobody will buy our product. Let's ask the doctors to write prescription.
Yes, sir.
That also did not work. Now, third year, 2001, they want to do a consumer campaign.
Yes, sir.
These people have lost their mind. Because Johnson & Johnson, after all, is a pharma company. Their mindset work like pharmaceutical company. They think this is a prescription drug. They can't sell consumer product as effectively and as bad, as much better as liver. You see this?
Yes, sir.
You look at the, you know, Johnson & Johnson. I think you must look at it. All of you, please. Johnson & Johnson has developed this Banacol, but their pharma mindset has not gone out of their minds. What is the formula that they are using in Banacol to reduce the cholesterol? Sanjana?
So they're using phenol esters.
Fantastic. Is it really efficacious? Does it really reduce cholesterol?
So it's been reported that it would reduce cholesterol by up to 14%.
14%. And how much take control reduces cholesterol by?
7 to 8%, sir.
Oh, this is even better, right? You see, yes. This. Now, how much is required to be reduced to save yourself from heart attack?
Not sure, sir.
It is written there, I think about 5% or something.
5%, yes, sir, 5%.
Now, see, these fellows have gone crazy, actually. They require, you know, complete marketing lesson. They should be sent to IMK. What they are doing is that they have created a product which they think is a great thing. And these R&D guys have created 14% reduction. They're patting their back, you know, by saying the great product, great product. But in turn, what they have created is something that consumer would never buy. Because you have now created a product which is, first of all, not giving you, it is overkill benefit. You require just 5% reduction by and large on an average. You are now giving 3 times reduction. That is okay. More benefit is better. More cholesterol reduction is good. No problem. I can eat more ice cream later. But the problem is that, you know, you are asking me to pay 10 times more price. And then you say that I will spend huge amount of money. This is the star product. I have developed margarine, which can reduce the innovative product. $49 million you blow off. And then, you know, come out with a volume share, which is less than your competitor, half of that. Bad marketing, product price, promotion, everything is bad. You realizing? Sanjana?
Yes. Yes.
And why it is bad? Because the strategy is bad. Please understand, these marketing mix elements can be fixed only if you have right strategy. Their strategy, they don't know whether this is, who are they competing with? What the hell is this Banacol brand manager of Johnson & Johnson don't know?
Yes, sir.
They think that this cholesterol reducing drug. Now you tell me, what is the market size of cholesterol reducing drugs? In 2 pages, you have fantastic information in this case.
Yes, sir. Yes.
What is the size of the market cholesterol reducing drug?
It's $1.3 billion US, that margarine market was.
That is the margarine market. Very good. You have done calculation, right? Margarine market is 1.3 trillion or billion, right?
Billion.
1.3 billion. On what basis you have calculated that?
No, not calculated. So it's given in the case.
Acha. Okay. Yes. Which page? Let me see.
First page only. So first page, last paragraph, first line. $1.3 billion US margarine market.
On the first page itself, it is written. Yes, very good. And you can calculate also 2.2 share, you know, if you look at, and you have volume $27 million, you know, dollars and all that. I mean, you can calculate, but you have given this size, 1.3 billion. That's a margarine market. That is the size of the margarine market, right?
Yes, sir.
What is the market size of cholesterol reducing drug? If you have to reduce cholesterol, generally what would you do? You will take tablets. I am taking it. You may not know. That's why 45 plus age group is the target audience. But you require to take tablet in normal case, right? There are already tablets selling in the market. That's what Johnson & Johnson is trying to do. They are asking doctors to prescribe margarine. If you go to page number 2, you will find that, you know, in the third paragraph,
category sales of cholesterol lowering drugs. So that reached $700 million per month.
$700 million versus $1.3 billion.
Yes, sir. Yes.
One parameter. Take a look at this. You know, the maximum potential for this is $701 million. There, if you look at, this is, you know, the food product. If you want people to, you know, less spend, less on the, even functional food products, people can start buying margarine, right? So total amount of money that I spend on, you know, healthy oil or something, that also I can divert it to this. And, you know, your functional food market is $17 billion in the US. Paragraph number 2.
Yeah.
The food industry, if you take all the food, 1.5 trillion, it's such a huge category. Forget about all that. Even if you take a look at margarine, you are talking about 1.3 billion and you are talking about 701 million. Now you tell me how easy it is to, you know, get one margarine user to switch to cholesterol reducing margarine user. It is very difficult, but compared to somebody who's taking cholesterol reducing drugs to get into cholesterol reducing margarine.
This is relatively easier, sir, because they already have intention of like
using. They're already having margarine. They would like to have that, right?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Now look at J&J. They are saying that $49 million we got, our ROI is bad, so we'll try to start selling it as physicians. You know, so let physicians write prescription of margarine. Do you think doctors will write margarine butter in their prescription? I mean, some of them would write. They can write anything. He'll write toothpaste also, so long as there's fancy name. But, you know, it's not a good idea. Actually, doctors would say that my credibility goes off if I start prescribing butter. I should, you know, be prescribing some fancy, you know, tablets.
Yes, sir.
So the whole idea of positioning these against drugs is not good. And now advertising can do little, but, you know, even the product in price has to be changed to compete against, you know, Unilever. You see this, how bad marketing, how much worse it can get.
Yes, sir, Anjana? Very bad.
Now you tell me, so frequency, do you agree that the more is better in a context like this?
Yes, sir.
Because you are trying to sell something which is, you know, very, very expensive compared to your competitor. And a relatively new, people don't even know the category benefit.
Yes, sir.
Okay, now come to target group. Very quickly, let's look at, you know, what basis you have decided, given priority.
1 minute, sir.
Yes, that's the spreadsheet.
So, in the income, we would obviously be looking at higher income, household income target groups. Why? Because only. So they would be able to afford something.
You can't take decision on this, you know, which one, this is a weight that you have. So first of all, what you have to do is you have to go by, first of all, those people who are less than 45, their hearts are stronger, right? As I'm speaking to you in excitement, my heart is now started paining, right? Anyway, I'm okay. But what I'm trying to say is that people who are 45 below are not the target audience. So that obviously will, group number 9 will become worstest, you know, group, right?
Yes, sir. Yes.
All right. Now come to 45 plus. Obviously, you know, you have to go by table 7. In the case, have you seen table 7 by any chance?
Yes, sir. 1 minute.
Yeah, you so found it. Not table 5. Table 5, sorry. Page number 10, not table 7. Page number 10. All of you, please. Sanjana, yes, did you find?
Yes, I found.
What is it?
So it shows in
What is the title of the table?
Benecol target group.
So you have target group and the populations are given how they are dispersed.
Yes, sir.
Obviously, where you have more population in your target audience, you should try to sell more.
There. Yes, sir.
As simple as that, isn't it? We were looking at that indexes and all that. Population percentages and, you know, the current sales, but you are not selling anything right now. So, you know, obviously you'll go by the population and expect that as much as the population you will sell in that particular segment. Right or wrong? So the first level of, you know, better, worse and all that, you know, you will have to do based on this. Where there are more number of people, you know, obviously that is a more attractive group. Isn't
yes,
it?
Sir.
After that, you will have to do adjustment based on what is the product on offer, right?
Right, sir.
You remember, like you were saying, moisturizing lotion in Kerala and Delhi cannot be sold just because target audience's percentages are higher or lower, right?
Yes, sir. We have to look at those characteristics.
So now you will look at the pricing characteristics and say that although the price is, you know, the percentage population is higher in lower than 50,000 K, I will not give them higher weightage.
Right, sir.
So once you have adjusted your, you know, high low based on above and below average, based on this percentages, you will have to do minor tweaking, right?
Yes, sir, we would have.
Based on the price, so far as the income level is concerned, how will you take decision between men and women?
So I think it's somewhere given.
Would you change weight for women and men in any way, or just go by the percentage population? Any adjustment required there, Sanjana?
So in the case it's given, post-menopausal women also would be more prone, but on an average, men would want this more.
Mm. Men generally, you know, have a lot of stress and they kind of have weak hearts also. So they suffer from heart attack, whether you agree or not. But, you know, the question is that, you know, have you lived in boarding school or you've been living with your family? Any chance of living with your mom and dad? And
yes, sir. Undergrad was at home.
Achha. So who buys grocery products in your house? Any idea?
My mom, sir.
Oh, most of the houses in America also in 2000, you know, moms used to buy, right?
Yes, sir.
Because when it comes to what do you eat in the house, it's a woman's decision. I cannot decide what I'm going to eat tonight. My wife will decide. And everywhere, I mean, of course, things are changing. You know, we are all old generation. But in your generation, I don't know what will happen. But in 2000, certainly in United States, Banacol situation, if you have to anticipate the consumer behavior, the consumer behavior is the decision maker for the food products in the house, in the family. Everybody, you know, will be eating as per the lady's decision.
Yes, sir.
You see, now the man is going to have more heart attack or woman is going to, that is not an important. Who decides whether which brand of margarine will come into the house? It's a woman. Okay. Now you go and tell that, you know, your husband is having weak heart and he will die and all that. So you will have more problems. So you buy this. That's a different story. But the decision, your target audience is woman because she's deciding the purchase.
Yes, sir. Absolutely.
So maybe you can adjust a little bit to more tilting towards woman. I mean, logically, so this is a, these are the marketing decisions that comes into picture. You see, what about county?
So in this table, the based on county, how much of percentage of our target group?
That population you have already considered. See, that's the first level of consideration. But are you going to do any tweaking? You see what I'm trying to say? Your percentage of county A plus B is higher, right?
Yes, sir.
And C plus D is, you know, lower. So obviously important target you should look at is A plus B county.
Yes, sir.
But I am saying that suppose if that is, you know, what is it called? You know, double the parameter. So if you're going by this, you know, percentage dispersion, you will give it much better A plus B. and C plus D you will give much worse. No, not much worse. You will give it, you know, average, for example. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Now, would you like much better to slightly better and, you know, take average to slightly better or something like that? That's the adjustment that we have to do. So by and large, you know, it should be these percentages are the broader, you know, weightage that you may give. But minor tweaking, you'll have to do based on, you know, where you are going to, you know, see more effectiveness of your advertising. Who is more likely to buy? Are people in A plus B county or C plus D county? Like just now we say that between men and women, women are more likely to buy. For example, you know, see, one is the percentage of audiences. But the second is, suppose if men and women both are exposed to advertising, who is more likely to get convinced first about your banner call? Woman.
I think so, yeah.
So likewise, you know, between these counties, you know, if you have to decide, I'm just giving you an idea. If you look at Exhibit 7, Sanjana?
One minute. Looking. Yes, sir.
Exhibit 7. What is it basically? What is painted here? You are able to figure out?
Yes, a margarine used by female homemakers.
And what kind of numbers are given? Do you have something familiar here? You have what are called index numbers.
Yes, sir.
Index
is based on income, age group, etc.
Right. So it is like yesterday, last time we were looking at, you know, Bihar, Madhya Pradesh and all that. That is the county A, county B, county C. If you add this together population, you will have 90,000 women population in US, right?
Yes, sir.
Similarly, when you look at, so that's only the geography. Remaining basically are based on the education, age group, income level, marital status, race, all kinds of, you know, divisions they have done to the US women population. And, you know, they have worked out percentage dispersion of target audience in the first two columns.
Yes, sir.
And in subsequent column, they are now looking at the user data. They have got the buyer data, how much of buyers in each of these market and how they are dispersed. And they have further segregated them based on the light, medium and heavy users.
Yes, sir.
Now you tell me, Sanjana, should you be targeting all margarine users or you would be targeting heavy margarine users or light margarine users or medium margarine users?
Heavy margarine users. Sir.
Why?
So 1 minute. So heavy is defined as more than 4 LBS.
Huh. So what? Obviously, people who are heavy buyers are going to be
more experimental.
They will try specialist marketing, right? So, for example, if you are eating ice cream once in a 6 month, right? You will say, give me vanilla, whatever is the ice cream, vanilla ice cream, I will eat and, you know, finish it off. But suppose if you are having ice cream every evening, then you would be saying, are, aaj kaun sa hai? Let me try a new one and all that. You see what I'm trying to say?
Yes, sir. And also Benecol would be reducing approximately 14%. So probably heavy users would be willing to use.
Heavy users would be willing. See, when I'm consuming once in a 6 months, you know, one tub of margarine, it is okay. You know, even if I have a little bit of cholesterol, I'm not going to die. That's how people will think. But if I just love margarine, you know, every day I have to, you know, finish 1 pound of margarine on my, you know, full bread loaf. Then obviously, you know, I'm a heavy margarine. I should be more conscious about trying margarine, which is cholesterol reducing margarine, healthy margarine. Am I right or wrong?
Yes, sir.
And also I would be more aware because I'm deep into that category. I want to know everything about margarine because margarine is my life. Heavy user.
Yes, sir. Heavy users should be given
now,
more.
Within that, you know, you look at which county is having more index and which is having less users. Accordingly, that you may do adjustment. I'm just kind of giving you pointing pointing out that, you know, all these data are very, very useful and you have to use them to decide. We don't have time, so let's move. Okay, is that clear?
Yes, it's clear.
Okay, so now target audience zero. What is the next decision? Media vehicle input. Very quickly, we have to go in the break after 2 minutes.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. So,
what is this? What are you trying to do here? Impact factor. What does it mean? Where will you give more impact?
I would be giving more impact where I can reach my target audience.
Is going to be decided. That is already decided. So you select that particular vehicle. You don't have to decide impact factor then. Okay, for example, in the next decision that you will take, that whether you will advertise in online Microsoft or you're going to advertise in Wall Street Journal, you decide you 0 or 1 or 5 insertions. Where your audience is and you advertise, is as simple as that. But what are you doing here in this spreadsheet?
We are giving impact factors for these media.
What is this impact factor? Have you read the case?
Yes, sir.
Okay, now go to page number 9.
Yes, sir.
Impact. Do you see a paragraph titled impact?
Yes, sir. Yes.
What does it mean? Can you read it out loudly for everybody's benefit? First line.
Yes. This is an assessment of the relative qualitative advertising value of a medium or vehicle.
Read further.
It might be based on the editorial content, format, use of color, or other variables which could affect the medium or vehicle's effectiveness in achieving one's advertising goals.
This has got little to do with the audiences in your target, whether that particular vehicle reaches in your target audience or not. That data is already there, and based on that, you decide whether you want to take it or not. But you also have to look at whether the effectiveness of that audience reach is going to be more or less, right? Based on the impact. Just now I was telling you, remember that, you have certain products which can be better suitable to, you don't expect to see Banacol advertised on Wall Street Journal. I mean, does it look good? Do you expect that? And even if it is advertised, would you pay attention?
No, sir. No.
Because you are not thinking about margarine at that point in time.
Yes, sir.
Forget about audience. Even if women, people are reading, if not Wall Street Journal, let's assume that, even if they see Wall Street Journal can be read by women also, isn't it?
Yes,
it's not a demographic. It's not a woman's magazine. So suppose if it is read by woman, do you think, and the woman also reads Cooking Light, where do you think, she would be more thinking about the margarine category?
Cooking Light, sir.
And when I'm thinking about margarine, when I'm thinking about what should I make for my family, how do I remain healthy, my figure should be better and I should not be obese, what? I mean, at that point in time, your brand should talk about the benefit, no?
Yes, sir. Yes.
When I'm searching for a new job, my boss is firing me, that time you're telling me my heart, anybody is going to stop. Irrespective of whether I eat, cholesterol reducing margarine or not. So what I'm trying to say is this is something that you're doing. I would like to give highest weightage to Cooking Light because that's the most suitable. You are talking about cooking, margarine, food item. You are also talking about light cooking, which is healthy cooking. This is a functional food. There is no better vehicle than that. Isn't it?
Yes, sir.
I would also like to see whether I can, consider give higher impact to better homes and gardens. Because cholesterol is my home, my family's health.
Yes, sir.
I would like to consider TV early news or not news, daytime TV.
Okay.
Right? What I'm trying to say is that you have to look at based on that impact, not the numbers of audiences.
Right, sir.
That's the qualitative judgment that we are looking based on the editorial content, format, color, etc., etc. Where, what kind of ad will go?
Yes.
Now, what is a creative execution? This is more of a print advertising because you want to talk about the dangers of cholesterol. You want to talk about why, what is Stanolister? How does it working? You have to persuade people that margarine can actually reduce your cholesterol.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Radio pe you can't tell the entire story. You have to have print medium.
Right, sir.
So those are the factors you will consider to give this impact factor qualitatively. And after doing all that, you go to the media decisions. You see, Sanjana, go to the spreadsheet number 4, fourth tab.
Yes, sir.
Now you look at which particular vehicle, you will be taking. Obviously, you will have to look at the target weighted CPM.
Yes, sir.
Combined with the vehicle, which by default is something going to fit with the creative execution. And, your category, right? So between Better Home and Garden, Cooking Light, both are fitting my category and all this. If I have to choose between them, I will choose Cooking Light because that is lower CPM.
Yes, sir.
But I would not go for, Wall Street Journal, for God's sake, because it's a higher cost, as well as the fit is also not there with my category and creative.
Right, sir.
And then, so maybe I would go for 4 insertions in Cooking Light, 4 insertions in Better Home and Garden, and maybe, some kind of TV daytime, 9 to 4 p.m.
Right, sir.
4 spots there. And finish it off rather than taking one insertion everywhere. The whole idea is that I would like to reach to people who are heavy, healthy users, very small portion to begin with, at more number of times, not the large number of people at less number of times, because this category is a niche category. It would appeal to the heavy margarine users who are health conscious, at least in the beginning.
Yes, sir.
And of course, it's an expensive. So I'm going to go for niche people, but I would persuade them fully by, educating them that margarine can actually reduce and you should not go for take control, go for better one. You will have more efficacious product here. You have 14% reduction because it is stanol esters, not stanol or whatever that take control uses.
Right, sir.
You see. So anyway, I hope you got the idea as to how you kind of go about looking at your advertising campaign media.
Yes, sir. Got it.
And all of you, I hope you also followed what I and Sanjana were discussing. We'll go in for a break. We'll come back at 4:30 and then we will go further. All right. Thank you. 4:32 we will meet. Okay, let's see. 4:33.
All right, I think we will continue. Once again, wishing you a very happy new year, particularly for people who are joining later, generally not in time. For them, my best wishes. We will continue. We were looking at media planning, and we looked at that, you know, there are both qualitative as well as quantitative analysis and input that has to go in developing effective media plan that actually would produce results for the brand. Because ultimately, we are not just doing media planning to reach people. We want to reach people effectively so that they get converted into buying our brand and become customers. And hence, you have to keep in mind some qualitative factors as we're looking at. For example, if you talk about print media, you have dailies, which are newspaper, and you have magazines. And you find that, you know, they have their own unique characteristics. And when you are evaluating, where to spend more money, you not only have to look at the quantitative factors in terms of how many people are reading newspapers, but you also have to look at whether it is category, medium fit, whether it is creative execution medium fit, and several other factors, including issues like local coverage. The advantage of print newspaper dailies is that you get a lot of geographic selectivity, which means that you can, if I want to reach, say, for example, only South Bombay, Bandra onwards, down south, all the way up to Colaba, I can actually, take Times of India Sobo split and advertise in that. And it will, be charging only for audiences in that particular region. I can go to North Bombay, I can go to Central Bombay, likewise. Similarly, you can have, of course, like Calicut, if you want to reach, you can go to Calicut edition of Matrubhumi or Malayala Manorama and advertise. So you have a lot of geographic selectivity, but you don't have demographic selectivity. If you advertise in the newspaper, you will reach to everybody, irrespective of male, female, younger people, older people, rich people, poor people, and things like that. So by and large, demographic selectivity is not that geographic selectivity is high. You also find that, there is very high announcement value, which is an advantage for the newspaper. Because if you are, say, for example, introducing new, like Banacol, if it is advertising for the first time, newspaper would provide announcement value, right? So if you have something newsworthy to announce, like for example, introducing new flavors, introducing new pack size, introducing, launching a new product itself, then newspaper by default would be suitable for those kinds of creative executions, which are more focusing on the announcement. You also have some limitations, like for example, production, reproduction quality is not that high because it's printed on the newsprint. So if you have very good color, if you want to print Aishwarya Rai's picture as a model and talk about L'Oreal advertising, it will not work that effectively because, the newspaper quality is bad, unless you go for color supplements like Sunday supplements and all. And hence, for certain kind of product categories, newspaper may not be a good idea. But if you are looking at, say, for example, print media, this kind of high executional impact advertisement, then magazine could be a better choice. So what we are saying is that you have to, keep certain characteristics of the media class while actually, deciding. So broader, allocations would be by the reach and the audience, reach within the audience, and then fine tuning you have to do. You have to be conscious about these factors, overlay this on the basic quantitative reach data, and then take a decision. Sometimes, print has certain advantages, like, say, for example, credibility is much higher, right? So, for example, here you have Times of India actually promoting print as a medium of advertising by saying print is proof, because digital, everybody is doing. But people don't believe digital as much because there's a lot of fake news, a lot of this one, but print is proof. So you have to keep such qualitative factors in mind while considering media allocation, because ultimately it has to work. The idea is not just to reach audiences. The audiences have to be reached effectively. Magazines, as we are saying, that the advantage is less of geographic selectivity, more of demographic selectivity. So if you want to reach women, you advertise in Cosmopolitan, or if you want to reach men, you advertise in Men's World, or you know, something like that. If you want to reach GQ, or if you want to reach children, you advertise in children magazine. You want to reach senior citizen, you advertise in that. So you have magazines, you know, which can provide demographic selectivity. But geographic selectivity is not there. Suppose if you want to reach women in Kanpur, you cannot take a magazine like Femina and say that I will reach only in Kanpur. You know, you will end up creating a lot of waste because you'll be reaching to other places as well. But the advantage is that it has got good reproduction, and hence the quality you know, of reproduction is very high, very glossy, sleek advertisement you'll be able to see. And hence, if you want to show something which is very high impact like this, you know, you will find that magazines are good places to advertise. So if you have, you know, a high-end fashion label to be advertised with, you know, beautiful models, you can't spoil their beauty by advertising in newsprint. You have to go for these glossy pages, and the impact would be very different. But the disadvantage of magazine is that, you know, it has got a lot of secondary reach, and lead time is much higher. Sometimes they are monthly magazine, fortnightly magazine. So you cannot just, you know, you have to wait for, you know, your ad to come and things like that. And hence, if you have topical advertisements, something which are more announcement centric, then it is not a good idea. And also you find that there's, you know, a lot of duplication. So if you are looking at creating high frequency, you can take magazine along with, you know, dailies or television. So that is why, you know, I was suggesting that, you know, for products like Banacol, Cooking Light, if you are taking, and, you know, Better Homes and Gardens, something like that you're taking, you can take, you know, daytime television, you know, to kind of create some good overlap and high frequency, low reach kind of objective. Television, of course, you know, it has very great value. So as a multimedia medium, and hence you have the sight, sound, and motion. You can create a lot of entertainment on this. So if your creative execution is about entertainment, you should go for television kind of thing. Of course, allow a lot of, you know, repeat viewing kind of thing. Repetition, because high frequency repetition, if you want to do, again, television is good idea. If you look at radio, again, the advantage is geographic reach, because FM radio stations, you know, are different, 99.96 and 99.7 and 96 point something. You know, you have places to places, different frequency and different radio jockey and different program. So you can actually have geographic selectivity, providing local coverage. It can be a good reminder medium. Since, you know, you are only working with one sense of audio and low involvement, very passive consumption of the media, you have to, you know, have very, you know, high power message, like a lot of interesting music, which stays get into the mind, you know, for radio to work. Now, once you have done media selection, when you do media vehicle selection, we know that what you have to do is optimization, like what we were looking at in Banacol case. So, you know, just to kind of consolidate our understanding, which we were talking about in case of Banacol, what you are doing is that, first of all, you have to select your media objectives, which is in terms of how many people you want to reach in your target audience, how many times. And generally, you first decide the frequency, which is the effective number of times you want to reach the audience. And then what you do is that within the budget, you try to maximize the reach at that effective frequency. That's what you're trying to do in Banacol. Sometimes you fix up the effective frequency and you know how many people you want to reach. So for example, in this particular case, objective is to reach people at least two times to be effective. And there has to be at least 30% audience you want to reach.
So you have reached frequency target given. When you multiply this, you know, you will get what is called GRPs. But anyway, you have this target. Now, what you will be doing for vehicle selection? For example, you selected one media vehicle, which is Chitrahar. What is the audience delivered by this vehicle? 68% TRP. So TRP is 68%. 68% of the audience you are reaching. So do you think your objective is met, 30% audience? No, it is not met, because 30% you want to reach effectively at 2+ frequency. If you are advertising only once on Chitrahar, you may reach 68% of the people, but that's not effective. In order to be effective in your advertising message communication, you have to reach at least 2 times. So you have to add one more sort of vehicle to create an appropriate overlap, whereby you reach 30% of the audience at least 2 times. So in the step 2, you will take a vehicle. Now you have multiple choices here. For example, you have 2 shows. You can take either of them. So for example, if you take Hindi feature films, TRP of that show is 60. You advertise on Hindi film, you have chance of 60% people, 60% of the audience you can reach. Rangoli, 50% of them. So which one will you take? And CPRP is the same, cost per TRP is the same. So obviously you will take for Hindi feature film. No, may not be a good idea, because your objective is to reach 30% audience at effective 2%. You have to be concerned about, I have already taken Chitrahar because that is got highest TRP and cost CPRP is roughly about same. Now the second one which I add should create an overlap, which actually gives me 2+ frequency at least of 30% audiences. Now take a look at this situation, that when you consider the overlap, since you have 2 options, Chitrahar is already selected in step 1. If you take Chitrahar and Rangoli, you have 32% common audience. If you take Chitrahar and Hindi feature film, you have 26% overlap. So suppose if you take Hindi feature film, considering that it has got higher TRP, your GRP would be 128 as against 118 in case of the other program. Although your GRPs are high, your objective of 2+ at 30% is not achieved in this particular case, because the overlap created by these two is only 26%. And hence, if you want to achieve this objective, you will have to add the third program, which may end up creating, perhaps 2+ at 30%. So that will become expensive. So the better option perhaps is Chitrahar and Rangoli, which will create, 2+ at 30%, with these two particular shows. So that is what you keep trying. And so when you take, your iteration to, minimize the cost and, CPM would only be at the last stage in banner call case. You have to fix the frequency, because the objective should be in terms of the effective frequency and how many people you reach. Here, reach is not to be fixed, because you are optimizing reach at a fixed budget constraint. So budget is fixed, your effective frequency is, now you have to optimize. But you have to also decide what is the effective reach in terms of target audience and the impact of the vehicle. Once you do that, you can then do iteration to, arrive at the highest reach and the lowest weighted CPM. In banner call case. But what is important is fixing the frequency and other weights of the target audience and vehicle. Now please understand that the whole idea of effective media planning and efficient media planning, a good media planning, is to avoid creating waste. Not a single exposure should be wasted. So first of all, you should be very appropriate in your objective. But having said the objective, your choice of vehicle selection should be such that it should deliver exactly what the objective is. For example, take a look at this situation in this particular chart. This is what is called reach curve. You have 2 reach curves delivered by 2 different media plans. One is pink, other is blue. And what you see here is your objective is to maximize the reach at 3+. Now, what is the maximum reach that is delivered by blue plan at 3 frequency at least? Maximum reach is 60. What is the maximum reach delivered at 3+ by pink media plan? Again, 3+, because you can see that the line is going straight. 3+, right? So both media plan delivers 60% reach maximum. That's the maximum reach that delivered at 3+ frequency. Now, which media plan is good? Perhaps both have their own weaknesses. I believe that pink media plan is worse than blue one, but blue is also worse. The ideal media plan should be something like this. What you are saying is that there is a 3+ maximum reach 60 or a little more than that. But after that, there is no waste happening. 4+, 5+, it should be minimum 0 frequency. Take a look at this particular media plan. It attempts to bring it 0, but it's not happening too low here. You are still creating a lot of waste here. More importantly, you are creating a lot of wastage here. There is no point in reaching these audiences at 1 frequency, 2 frequencies. So you can change the media vehicle, create overlap in such a way that, you know, you go to the, you create a situation which is something like this. If you take a look at pink plan, you have very good, you know, there's hardly any waste here, right? So you are reaching people at 3+, but you are continue reaching a 60% audience at 4+ and 5+ as well. There's a lot of wastage happening here. So the ideal media plan should deliver maximum reach, you know, at a desired frequency itself. Now, please understand this is 1+, 3+, 2+ and 3+, which means 1+ would take into account all those 3+ as well. And hence this line would be made. But if you calculate, if you draw this curve, reach curve at exact frequency, they would look something like this. The same curve. So you are, you know, what you are doing is you are taking the difference between the 1+ and 2+. Audience is reached at frequency 1 and 2. What is the difference? It is 0, 0. And hence this will be 0. And then, you know, you will have 60% reach and like this. So the same curve when you draw for blue line, you see that there's wastage happening here. There's wastage happening here. You draw it at your pink line, you're actually finding that a lot of wastage happening at 4+, 5+. So what we are trying to say is that when you select media vehicles, you should try to select in such a way that, and that's why you require optimizers. So you have software packages which actually do this iterative process to, you know, find the most optimum. So you just have to give the media objectives of what is the effective frequency, what is the budget credit constraint, like what we had in this Banekal case. And computer will automatically select the best combination of media vehicles and appropriate insertion to deliver a plan which actually is optimum and has minimum wastage so far as the exposures are concerned, because every exposure costs you. So you have softwares like for print media optimization, vehicle selection, you have Sesame, you have for Television Express Expert. All these, I think Nielsen products, but what is popular now is Bark, Media Workstation, which is, BARC's, television planner, and radio, you have what is called Radar, which is using RAM data. So this is just to kind of give you an idea about the screenshot, And then you have Bark Media Workstation. Once you have selected media vehicle, the story is not yet over. Media planning requires media class selection. Once you have selected print media, you will have media vehicle division, Times of India, Hindustan Times, Hindustan, Hindu, whatever. Having selected Times of India or Hindustan Times, you then will also have to say within that newspaper, which will deliver a specific number of audiences, you still can make a choice and make your advertising work better if you select the right position in the vehicle. For example, when you talk about newspaper, should you advertise on front page or back page? Should you advertise on right hand side page or left hand side page? Should you because one is the prices are different, as well as you have to figure out that where your advertising is going to work better. Should you advertise, in color or black and white? Should you advertise in half page or should you advertise in 5 square centimeter? These are the decisions that you have to take, which are called media option decision. Likewise, newspaper, front page, back page, color, black and white, full page, half page. In magazine also you have full page, half page, color, black and white. You also have double spread, you have bleed, you have full spread. So you have variety of different options in magazines as well. In television also you can have, whether you want to go for 10 second spot, 30 second spot, 60 second spot, whether you want to have in the first commercial break, second commercial break, before the show, after the show, and likewise. So these are basically the media option decision, and they have to be based on some broad research and guidelines. But at times, so you know, it requires a lot of experimentation, innovation, to create. The whole idea is to, having reached creating exposures, how do you really grab maximum attention of the users on your advertising? Because readership data or viewership data only says that this many people consume this particular media. It doesn't guarantee exposure of your advertising. In order to make them see your ad, you have to focus on the option. So what you do is that you try to choose an option which by giving higher price, if it produces better effect in improving your ROI, you can go for it. For example, in last 5 to 10 years, the biggest thing that has happened in print media innovation or sort of popular way of advertising to make sure that the audiences notice your ad. If you advertise in Times of India, it is quite possible people may not see it. But if you use, for example, jacket ad, now this is what are called jackets. So on the newspaper, you have an additional sheet of paper, which is like a jacket, is full commercial. It's all advertising, commercial space. So this is, as you can see, is Times of India masthead, but this is a full commercial space. And back page also would be like that. And inside that, you will have the headlines and the first front page. So all these magazines for newspapers are now going for jacket ad. It's most popular, and it is even becoming more regular with this grocery stores, modern format, and online particularly. So Amazons of the world, JioMart, take a look at this Christmas, right? This a week before in those Sun Times jacket ad. You see this front and back, and because these people do what are called catalog advertisement. This is a catalog format. The creative format is catalog ad. So what they do is that they create a catalog by putting the product picture, price, discount, etc. And it's like all tabular format, right? And the whole idea is to show the prices. So for them, newspaper, the retail is greatest, sort of category, beneficiary, greatest beneficiary of print media, because it's geographic selectivity, more topical advertising, because the discount this week may not be discount on next page week, etc., etc. So this is a catalog kind of thing. But take a look at this page here. This Christmas actually, and you have one full ad. I mean, this much size, obviously is going to cost you more because the price of the ad space is by square centimeter, versus take a look at the smart move of Amul. Amul uses this small 10 square or 10 by 10 kind of advertisement, but they spend money by giving premium on the position. Because they know that the right-hand side page, top corner, is the most viewed, noticeable corner or the space in the newspaper. So if I'm reading a newspaper, this is the space. This is the space where I'm going to pay maximum attention. So he says, why spend so much money in creating an ad? Of course, Reliance is doing it. Dhirubhai, they have a lot of money also. But say Amul is trying to, create effective, better ROI by, taking a smaller ad, but in a strategic location or media option. And what they also do is that they try to create this topical kind of advertisement to grab attention of the people, because look at this, on Christmas Day, they are doing Christmas advertisement and things like that. Media option could be something like this also. Take a look at this ad. It's a creative format, which is done very creatively so that you don't have a standard half page, full page, certain square centimeter kind of format, which is rectangular or square. take a look at this ad. Actually, this sachet or whatever pack, you know, of tea actually is jutting into the editorial. Look at this Dabur Honitus. Part of it is in the, you know, editorial text and this fellow's head and all that. So there is no boundary. It's like a, you know, it is interspersed with the, you know, the editorial content. And that actually increases the visibility of it. This is the, you know, innovation that we are talking about. So many times what actually happens is the media company and the creative people will have to work together and media team and the creative team has worked together and negotiate with the media company for high impact, innovative media option in the same newspaper. So instead of doing a simple ad like this, which may get missed out, you have higher chances of saliency and noticeability of an ad like this. You may have to pay a little extra, but you have to also look at whether the return on investment is higher. If you spend a little more money, but the response is going to be significantly higher, that money is worth spending for. Take a look at this, you know, ad, which is actually, you require integral calculus to, you know, work out what is the square centimeter that you are paying for. Magazines, they have their own way of, you know, innovative. Take a look at this gatefold kind of thing. You know, it opens, you know, like this. So you have gatefold, you know, two pages and then center spread. So Nike advertisement actually, you know, it's a quadruple spread advertisement that we are talking about. And you have innovation happening, which at times could be something like this. So take a look at this particular innovation, which was done for a brand called Volkswagen. And all leading newspapers, they create an advertisement. When the newspaper is delivered and you bring it in the house, it is like this. But when you open it, the newspaper starts talking. Just take a look at it. As you can see, you know, what they used was a kind of innovation wherein every newspaper, very expensive kind of advertising, but very effective because it not only created 100% exposures, you know, converted into awareness because people started knowing about Volkswagen, but more importantly, it also created spillover exposure by viral and, you know, sharing and things like that, and, you know, PR into the newspapers and magazines, because this, you know, became talking point for several people, because it was never heard that a newspaper, you open it and start talking. What they use was, you know, box like this. This is a device which is using a photodiode. So, you know, diode is a semiconductor device which acts as a switch, and you know, when the photodiode actually works with the, you know, light, and, you know, if the light gets exposed, you know, they will, the circuit will get closed and recorded music will, or, you know, message will start playing. So when newspaper comes, there's no light. When you open it, on the back page, you have this device which senses the light and, you know, you have message started playing. So these are the kind of innovation that perhaps improve your impact of your advertising. The audiences reached are same in terms of exposure, in some terms of number, but the impact is much higher. So that's what the impact essentially we are talking about, that it's not just how many people you reach, you have to reach them in an effective way. So these are the ways in which you can increase the effectiveness. So the same sort of technology they use the following year, the campaign was super duper hit. So next year, what they did is that, you know, they had this full page, front page advertisement, feel the shiver of excitement. And as you pick up the newspaper, again, photodiode on the back page, you know, it starts vibrating and shivering. And you feel a great feeling that, you know, here is a brand. So obviously you get curious, try to know more about Volkswagen Vento, and the impact goes up. But you have a lot of money, so you have to look at the ROI. When it comes to, you know, digital media, we'll talk about them in greater detail later, maybe tomorrow, I mean, next time when we meet. But just to give you an idea as to, you know, options, you know, how sometimes they can become very, very strategic in terms of improving your effectiveness of advertising campaign.
For example, here you are seeing is a YouTube pre-roll ad, and how it kind of improved the ROI for the campaign. But before we go out there, when you talk about television options, also you can have, 10-second, 30-second spot. One innovation that I remember, and I was just sharing with the previous class, is was a brand of candle. They took 8 hours of television spot. So at a stretch, 8 hours of time on a television. So for example, morning, 8 o'clock, you start, afternoon 4 o'clock, the entire thing is television commercial time for one brand. Now you might wonder that, is it a good idea? Who is going to watch that commercial for 8 hours? People don't even watch for 30 seconds, but they did this, it won the award also. I forgot the name of the brand, but the brand was for a product called Candle. And this candle had a promise, or the value proposition or positioning, which promised a great benefit or value called longest lasting candle, in the sense that, you burn the candle, it lasts for longer period of time. And what this ad did was, the creative was very simple. The beginning of the ad, they lit the candle and let the candle burn for the 8 hours. All that they did was, there was a scrolling text with a counter. We said that this candle has been burning for live counter kind of thing, that so many hours, and buy so and so candle, longest lasting candle, something like that. So it was a simple ad, but it created a lot of buzz and conversation around it. So sometimes you have 8 hour long media option. Sometimes you have less than 5 seconds. Just take a look at this. You see this in YouTube. If you advertise, the whole idea of Google is that there's a user control medium and interactive medium, so users should be in control. If they want to skip the commercial, let them skip it. And you can actually skip the commercial, you can pop down the banners that appear and all that. So and advertisers, if they say that if advertisers have to advertise, and Google says that our media is such that users can actually skip, but you pay to us, no advertisers would pay, right? So they, for advertisers also, they have an interesting thing. They say that if somebody skips your commercial in 5 seconds, you don't pay for it, but if they watch your commercial more than 5 seconds, you will have to pay for it. Advertisers are happy. Now, interestingly, these people say that, so there are two approaches. One approach is that, you make your commercial so good, particularly in the initial 5 seconds, that people get curious and don't skip your commercial if you want them to reach. But instead, these people say, we'll make a commercial itself, which is less than 5 seconds. I mean, of course, you have to buy 10 seconds or something, or you have to book or bid for 10 seconds spot. But you make an ad and, encourage people to skip the ad yourself. After 4 seconds. So people skip within the 5 seconds, you don't pay for it, and they have seen your ad. And the idea is gone in 5 seconds, because you just want to show that how powerful the engine of Audi is, that in acceleration perhaps, that you have in 0 to 100 kilometers,
you know, KMPH in 3 seconds or 4 seconds time. And that's what, you know, they did. And so media options, media vehicle, media class, those decisions you take. And finally, what you also have to take is what are called media scheduling and timing decisions. So when you make an annual plan of your advertising, you have to decide how you are going to schedule your ad. And of course, these decisions have to go by the seasonality. Obviously, you know, you can't sell, you know, your moisturizing lotion in summer and talcum powder in winter and things like that. So you will find that certain brands, you know, start advertising more in certain season because, you know, it makes sense to advertise in that season because there is a factor which is called recency factor. So like you have to have an optimum recency for an ad campaign to be effective, or optimum frequency or effective frequency, you should have something called recency factor, which means that an ad seen at the right time when the consumer are purchasing, you know, that you can, will have the highest impact. That's why, you know, you have what are called POP, point of purchase advertising also happening. You danglers, wobblers, you know, painting on the shops and, you know, in the restaurants, you have the coasters and so you have Kingfisher coasters. So obviously you'll go for Kingfisher beer or something like that. You will have, you know, table mat and all that, all advertisements, because, you know, the whole idea is to create a recency effect. People, when they're consuming at that point in time, the brand should talk to them. So one factor is that. Second issue is that, you know, how you schedule it. So one approach is that, you know, you bunch up all your gross exposure in a limited period of time, create a big bang advertising, and then, you know, wait for sort of some time without doing any advertising. And then again, you know, you do a big bang of advertising. The principle here is that, you know, when you do a big burst of advertising, a lot of noise in limited period of time, consumer would have very high impact exposure of your brand. And that impact would last for some time without you talking to them, which means if they've seen your big burst of advertising, at least for next couple of months, even if you don't advertising, your brand will be in the top of the mind. So sometimes brands try to do that, which is what is called flighting, you know, scheduling or burst kind of scheduling. The other, you know, approach is that, you know, you, instead of that, you do continuous advertising. So there is no burst. So in flighting, what you do is that, you know, you bunch up and then you don't have any advertising. Again, you do a burst and no advertising. Whereas in continuous, you will have equal amount of advertising throughout the year. And pulsing is actually a combination of that. So you have continuous advertising, which is having some small burst happening. So you would find that, you know, durables, automobile company, high, you know, involvement product, you will have flighted kind of schedule generally followed. And packaged consumer goods companies, you know, they follow what is called continuous kind of advertising. One is because they're the products which are purchased more frequently. Unless you have seasonality, you go for continuous kind of household products, some of the personal products, you know, you would go for continuous kind of advertising, packaged food, proprietary medicine, all that. And otherwise, you go for flighted kind of advertising, some of the products which are more seasonal, but packaged consumer goods kind of thing, or some products which are sold more in festive season. You go for pulsing kind of. So you will continue as advertising, but small burst at a, you know, appropriate time to take advantage of the opportunity of selling more. So certainly scheduling also sometimes is an important strategic decision. And many times, you know, you try to differentiate your advertising compared to the category. So, you know, you may find that two brands in the same product category might be following different kind of scheduling pattern to be different and, you know, take advantage of your advertising. For example, here you see this, in, you know, both Sandero and Indica Class B, segment B kind of cars. But Santro does continuous advertising, or used to do at some point in time. Indica would do what is called burst kind of thing. So you have high GRPs, or you know, cross exposures on one hand, and year September. So September is a time where a lot of these auto companies, for I don't know, depreciation or some such advantage, people might buy, you know, at that point in time. So they do a lot of September is a good season for auto company. But Santro has a lot of budget. They were almost the market leader in segment B at some point in time. So they were saying that, you know, we can do continuous, or they could afford to do that. Whereas Indica wanted to take advantage of burst approach and would do hardly any advertising in the remaining period and do a big bang advertising in short period of time during September. So you can look forward to you know, certain kind of approaches whereby your money produces better return on investment. That's what the strategy is all about. So when you're doing advertising, media planning, there are lots of areas where you can you know, think strategically and make your advertising expenditure work harder for your brand, or work better for your brand. So when you look at scheduling, what we are saying is that, you know, you have to first of all look at whether there is a seasonality, and you know, how you can take advantage of recency effect. Many times, you know, brands kind of try to advertise towards the end of the month because they know that most of the household products and grocery products are purchased towards the end of the month or early first week of the month, because that's when the salaries are received by people and, you know, monthly household items are purchased during that. So if you don't advertise, you know, around that time, you lose the recency effect, and the other competing brand, which is more recently advertised, the consumer may end up buying that brand because of top of the mind awareness. So you have to look at those issues. You also have to look at that, you know, do you have really enough budget if you want to be continuous advertising, or else you go for burst or things like that. So I think that completes our discussion on media planning. If you have any questions, you know, you can raise now. Although I think we have completed in time 5:16 already. But if you have any questions, I am willing to take them right now. Any questions, please? No questions. All right. My best wishes for the new year once again. And I will see you again on Monday or Tuesday, whenever your next class. And next time we are going to look at advertising on online media. And you will have a case that you have to submit assignment for and come prepared with your analysis to be presented in the class. Anyone can be asked in the class to share their analysis and defend their analysis. Christopher, Shubham, Abhishek, Aritra, anyone, you know, all of you should be ready, you know, with your analysis. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.